Hey everyone, on this episode of 6 Degrees with Mike McKenna, I'm joined by Todd Brown. You're going to hear some unbelievable stories in this one about guys like Ed Belfour, Curtis Joseph, Mika Kiprasov, Dominic Hasek, Chris Mason, Evgeny Nabokov. Have I named enough yet? I think you're going to enjoy it. Have fun.
So I think that you and I, talking with Todd Brown here, currently of Vaughn Hockey, formerly of Bauer for many years, brief stint at CCM, we first met in 2002. And do you remember who the Bauer rep was that sent me to see you?
Probably Rick Orpik.
It was. So I was playing at St. Lawrence University, and I had been using Bauer gear for a couple of years. And Mr. Orpik said, you need to go to Mississauga. I got a guy there who's going to set you up. You can see the factory. Get your gear for next season. And that's how we met.
Yeah.
So we probably did like 15 years or something. I don't know. 14. That's a lot to think about, isn't it?
It's been a long run.
Yeah.
A good run, though.
Your start in the industry, it's probably something I don't think we've ever even really talked about. How did you end up on the development and the gear rep side of things? Because you were a goalie growing up.
Right.
How'd that transition happen?
Well, when I realized that after my third year of Junior B that I wasn't really going anywhere, I had some opportunities to play in the East Coast League. And at that time, it was I think there were 8 teams or whatever. It was a small fraction of what it is today. I just realized, you know what, I gotta go on with school. So I went to Niagara College, got my associate's degree in marketing. And I knew if I couldn't make it in playing hockey, I'd want to do something in hockey. And I turned to the gear side because that's always something that interests me. And I started, part of my college program was a 1-year pay co-op. And I had the fortunate situation of hooking on with Brian's at the time, which is owned by the Stomp family, which just separated from Brian Heaton at the time when Brian Heaton broke off to start Heaton. So I actually interviewed with both Brian's and Heaton. Brian's was in Kingsville. Heaton was in Harrow, which was, I don't know, 15, 20 minutes down the road.
And Stomp ended up being a name down the road too.
It did.
Like, all these names keep resurfacing, right?
It did. Yeah. And I just had a better feeling that Brian's was going to be a better fit for me because they were more pursuant of the fact that they wanted to do something with me on a co-op situation where Dennis Smith and Brian Heaton at the time were the two principal people at Heaton come what may, we see what we might have for you, where the Brian's people were more pursuant of me working there. So I ended up working for Brian's on that 1 year, when then went back, finished my education, and Brian's offered me a position. But because it was such a family-run company, I didn't get a sense that there was a future for me. So I ended up moving on from there.
Did you go straight to Bauer after that?
No, I actually spent some time with a goalie brand, niche brand by the name of Forrester.
I remember Forrester.
Yeah.
I had a couple catalogs that had their stuff in it.
So Forrester had...
Man, we're digging up all sorts of stuff here. This is good.
Yeah, and they were a brand that had a strong following in Southern Ontario.
I mean, there were guys for the Sabres. Did Draper wear their stuff? Somebody wore Forrester stuff.
Marcus Ketterer.
Okay.
And yeah. Who was a big time prospect for the Sabres, who was in Rochester, was he was a Forrester guy. Rob Stauber.
Yeah.
Huge with the LA Kings with the painted pads. I remember Tony Piacente was an artist from Toronto who actually painted the he airbrushed the pads, which is probably the first that I recall in the 26 plus years I've been in the business of anybody having graphics on pads other than a standard graphic.
Was Stauber trying to one-up Rudy, you think?
Kind of.
I mean, and Rudy had some unbelievable gear.
I think it was Colin Forrester who was trying to one-up that, saying, what can we do? Like, everybody has these graphics that they apply, cut, and sew. What can we do different and visually more impacting? And he hired this Toronto artist, Tony, to actually airbrush a fanned out cards on Rob Stauber's pads.
I remember those. How'd they hold up?
Very well. Really? You know, obviously when you're layering paint on the facing of synthetic PU leather, it tends to crack and break down over time. And it gets heavy. because you're putting layers upon layers upon layers. But Rob never seemed to care. He just thought it was really cool that he could come out with this cool painted equipment. And it was something that we could do from a cut and sew application because of the intricacy of the design. So Forrester did very well in, like I said, in Southern Ontario and small pockets within the US. It was a small niche brand, but eventually the funding came to an end and the company went bankrupt. I moved on to Cooper at the time as a product manager and quickly.
Were you in the goalie division at this time?
I was in the goalie division at the time, yeah. And I quickly moved up.
How old were you at this point?
25.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I moved up pretty
young
quickly.
Young gun, we're bringing him in.
We brought him in and I ended up hiring Colin Forrester to be a designer at Bauer in the goalie division. So Colin originally employed me at Forrester, but I brought him over to Bauer because obviously his vision, his ability to design and pattern goal equipment, and I thought he'd be a good fit with our team. And it worked out well for many years. Colin was behind a lot of the reactor lines that was successful.
Never knew this, like the reactor fours, fives, threes.
Correct.
So the guy who made Forrester gear was behind the reactor five that I wore for so long, like five seasons worth. I made a throwback set to those last season.
Yep. Which make me proud.
Yeah. They might be coming again here in a little
Stevie
bit.
Stevie Dillon, Niagara Ice Dogs did a throwback stuff. So, you know, that all makes me proud because that's part of my heritage and my lineage.
Right. Because the Reactor 5 was a Cooper pad first.
It was. Yeah. When I started with Cooper and then we went to what we call Bauerization in 97.
I had the first set of Bauer pads in St. Louis.
That was a Herculean task to Bauerize everything. And that turned out, you know, Colin was one of three product designers. So I'm not saying that it was all Colin Forrester behind the designs of the product. We had a guy by the name of Brian Shikitani, Lee Mackey, who's still with Bauer, Bob Rook. I managed those guys. They were the designers behind the product. I wrote the product brief, the must-haves, the nice-to-haves, you know, the price point that we're trying to achieve. Where we fit in a competitive landscape, and they would come back to me and present to me their product designs. And we had a very special team. And there's a reason we had a lot of successes because we worked cohesively well as a unit.
That's cool. So you did this for a few years, and how long did it take you to get into the pro rep side though? Because it wasn't long before you were working with some of the big names in the NHL.
Yeah, it was almost immediately with, you know, obviously at Brian's, Darren Stomp, who was one of the principal owners of the company when I was there at the time. He felt that he needed to break me into the pro business. So I dealt with guys like Sean Burke, Ron Hextall, cut my teeth with those guys. You know, Stomper kind of let me, you know, feel my way through it, you know, take my slaps. And
say, were they giving it to you?
Yeah, they did.
Guys at that point.
I was a young guy. You know, I wasn't quite finished college at the time.
This was mid-90s, right?
Yeah, and they're like, who's this guy?
Right.
We're used to dealing with Stomper. Why is he sending this kid down to deal with us? But, you know, one thing that Brian's taught me is that if you are the face of the brand in the field, there should not be a question that you are unable to answer. So when I first started my co-op position, you know, it was really cool because I got to work in the cutting department. I got to work in the sewing department. I learned to sew, hand stitch, and work a serger machine, sewing machine. I learned to stuff pads. I learned to lace a glove because their philosophy was, if you don't know how it's put together or know the ins and outs of the properties of the materials that we use, then you can't answer these questions that these goalies have. So, you know, it was very hands-on. And by the time I, you know, learned all the ins and outs of the different processes and they felt comfortable that I had enough knowledge behind the materials and the processes and everything, that they would put me out in the field to. And this isn't a short period of time. This isn't 12 months. So this is a hurry-up offense.
Yeah.
And, you know, then I'm dealing with guys like Ron Hextall and Sean Burke and Trevor Kidd.
So were you behind, were you involved in some of those iconic sets that they had?
851, Thief, Hook.
A-Light.
A-Light, Ultralight.
Like those flame pads that Trevor Kidd had?
Yeah, Midnight Series. We were the first ones to do black with one accent with the crescent moon that was the logo.
All that,
and I still talk to Jaws at Brian's nowadays. I'm like, dude, you got to bring back the Midnight Series, especially that iconic half moon logo that we had on that. That was awesome.
Didn't Hextall have kind of a unique glove, if I remember right?
It was. He had no back thumb poly in his catcher, so he could really torque the glove. Because, you know, obviously he's one of the masters at playing the puck. And he felt that if he had a thumb insert in the back of his thumb, that would impede how far his thumb would move back and control a stick. So we eliminated that whole back thumb poly from his catch glove. He also had a floating tee in his gloves as well. Skate lace in the pocket. Everything that made it soft to collapse to get a better handle of the stick.
Incredible. But, I mean, I'm thinking of that Trevor Kidd set and the Sean Burke whale set and all these from back in the day. What was going through the minds of the guys at Brian's when these orders came in? Were the people there thinking of the design, or is that something that came out of Trevor's head?
You know, at the time, it's not like it is now with Rio and the staff that they have there. Back then, it was, I don't think they thought much about it. They just produced it.
Here's what I want. Let's do it.
And quality control back then in the days of Brian's was paramount. We had a guy running the plant by the name of Jess Sunderland, who was a stickler for quality. And actually, I worked quality for a while too, where if a glove didn't feel right, he gave me total latitude to reject it. And the glove people would be pissed. Like, are you serious? Like, I've been lacing gloves for 5, 6, 7 years and this kid's rejecting gloves. And you know,
who the hell's this guy?
Yeah, they're like, but I had a feel, right? Yeah. And I know that how the glove should feel. And if something didn't feel right, or if a pad didn't feel flex right, or something looked off, I would reject it before we get to the shipping department.
Even today, with how mechanized everything's become, do you still see a variance in the product at the end when it comes out?
Yeah, because a lot of it, you know, whether it's, you know, a lot of components are being pre-purchased and put together, there's still a human element to it. And there'll be variances. You know, there's people have good days, people have bad days, and they may be on or off. And you know, it's one thing with a glove, you know, like you go through this a lot of times with pro goalies, and you've been through it before. You've lived through the nightmare. One glove comes in, it feels great. The next glove comes in, it just doesn't feel right. And I look at lacing a glove.
Like Timmy Thomas's pads, right?
Oh, that's a whole different podcast. Like we could go off. I'm sure you want to get into that at some point. But getting to a glove, like when I laced a glove, you would hold it in your hand like a baby. And as you laced it, there
were you comfortable holding your daughters when they came out because of your previous experience?
Because I'm used to lacing gloves, right?
Yeah.
So you create, it's like you're cradling the glove, and as you're lacing it and using the pliers to put tension onto the laces, you know, you got to realize that if you pull too tight in certain situations, it pulls the components too tight together, and then it doesn't flex right, it doesn't feel right. You know, you just can't sit there and just look at the baby. You have to give it love. So same thing with the glove. If you're putting a glove together, you have to be cognizant of what you're doing. You just can't go through the rhythm and stare at the ceiling and, oh, that's a great tune, and sing along. You know, you have to pay attention to what you're doing and the tension you're putting on the laces, because if you don't, it'll affect the way the glove closes, the way the glove feels. And it's a human element. And you know, at the end of the day, when you said to me in the past, something doesn't feel right with this glove, I know probably what happened is that they didn't put enough attention to detail behind what they were doing at the time they're putting the glove together. And when you're putting so many parts together.
Yeah, because how many parts are in a glove?
You know, you're going to get different opinions on that. You know,
just a ballpark on these things.
You know, you're looking at over 200 pieces between embroidery, heat transfers, all the different componentry that go into it, the lacing and everything, eyelets, all that different thing. So, you know, there's a lot of pieces that go together and they all affect one another.
Yeah.
it's actually a science. And like to your point, you know, no matter if you're purchasing pieces and bringing them in, there's still somebody assembling it at the end of the day. And it's the assembly that really makes the difference between a good product and a bad product.
So going back when you went to Bauer, and it went from the Cooper transition to Bauer, mm-hmm. at that time frame, what were some of the advances in technology that came in that started to really change the game that you can think of?
Well, at Bauer at the time, we were one of the first companies that had pre-cut foams. So we had half profile foam. So if you looked at the Reactor 5, for example, the shin rolls.
Great
they
pad.
They weren't stuffed.
My favorite. Yeah.
Those rolls were actually half rolls of foam that were pre-cut that we ordered that way. And we would actually have a machine, and you visited the plant, that we would, you put the foam inside this machine, click a pedal like an accelerator, and it would shoot the foam in through a nozzle into the carcass of the pad. So it was perfectly stuffed. It was shot right in through forced air, compressed air. So and
by this point, nobody was using deer hair anymore, right?
We were at we the were time. Still at that we time. Were, yeah, for certain, you know, side gussets, but not for knee rolls or vertical okay. rolls or for shin rolls or anything like that. It was all pre-cut foams. Maybe boot. The inside-outside boot gussets before we got into pre-cutting foams. A lot of that we would use deer hair or kapok at the time, which is what you'd find in stuffed animals nowadays. You know, that type of material. But then we got more advanced and just started pre-cutting foams for the boots and whatnot. And that's how it's kind of evolved.
But at that point in time, you were starting to work with some pretty big guys on Bauer's side, too. And I think back to it, and the first name that comes up to me, somebody who was absolutely dominating the league, who happened to be named Dominic Hasek. Mm-hmm. You got to work with him while he was in Buffalo. What was he like to first work with? And then in terms of his equipment, what was unique about what he did?
He was an innovator. So he was wearing a mishmash of products, and at that time it was CSS pads, which was a
Cinderella shoe shop, right?
Correct. Yeah. Out of Buffalo area, Niagara Falls area.
Mitch Korn will love that reference.
Yeah.
That's one of his favorites.
Well, yeah. Exactly. And they tailored to really what Dom wanted, and Dom was an innovator. I remember the first time I met him, we had him in our factory in Mississauga, and he was very clear and concise about how he wanted his product to feel and perform. He's one of the first. So if I have to dissect his product, what made it unique? There was distinctions about every piece. His blocker, he had the hand very high up on the board because he goes, I push the puck. He wanted more of the blocker at the bottom of the palm of his hand so he could extend out further in the paddle down position, because Dom was always about the puck's perspective from the ice level up. I got to think like a puck. I'm elevating from ice level up. How can I get my equipment out further at the puck to take the trajectory away from the puck? So he felt by higher hand position, he could get more blocker at the bottom of his hand, paddle down to get out. But also, he thought, why do I need more blocker above my hand when I have my chest and arm bicep floaters, which overlap?
So he was getting more reach out of having it on the bottom.
And getting more reach.
I mean, I was the same way. I built my blocker the same way. I had a 1-inch offset like his that I saw he was getting more reach from it. But I never thought about it being from the puck's angle before.
He it's always really thought about from the puck's perspective. Always. Every and time that, I talked to him.
And that's what guys talk about now, whether it's aerial angle or box control mm-hmm. or head track, all these things. They're all different words for essentially what Dom was doing, it seems like.
He was ahead of the game. So that was the blocker. Going on to the glove, he's one of the first guys. Well, you know, the trend seemed to initiate out of Europe. Flat palm poly. So the finger side of your glove. You know, North America, a lot of the goalies like to pre-curve, they're curled, right?
Baseball style kind of, right?
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Dom was flat. So when I hold my glove, you know, whether you're 12... 2 or 3 nowadays, right? Back then, you know, most everybody held it out lower position, right? Dom looked like, how can I maximize my coverage? Well, if my fingers are curling, I'm not maximizing my coverage. So he had actually a flat palm poly assembly put in his glove where the finger side was totally flat. It looked like a big stop sign. Because he's like, it's not practical to think that you're catching shots that are flying so quickly at you. If I'm lucky to get my T-trap in front of it, it's going to settle into it. I want to show you the biggest coverage I can. So if I have flat fingers, I'm going to cover more net. And Dom was one of those gloves. Everybody talks about Henrik, who I had the pleasure of dealing with for many years. Dom's like, I don't really even need to close my glove. Because if it's open all the time, the puck's always going to sit in the trap. If I could get to it. If I could just get it in front of the puck, it's not practical to think I'm going to close it and catch it. So why do I need a glove that closes?
That's kind of a little known fact that we all know as goalies. And it's kind of a misperception from people that if that puck hits you in the palm of the glove, it's probably not staying in your glove.
Right.
It's not like a baseball. Like a baseball can hit you in the palm and you can catch it there. It's round. It sticks right there.
Yeah.
When the puck hits there, with the amount of protection we have, it's bouncing off.
Right.
So unless it hits the T-trap, it's going somewhere else.
Right.
So he's definitely ahead of the curve with that. And you'll see that with a lot of guys now who kind of pancake their glove out. Mike Condon did that a bunch. He would spread it as far as he could.
Yeah.
Hank does it. I think Curtis Joseph did it too, if I remember right, trying to maximize coverage like that.
Curtis was different too. He used to move his hand back in the glove. So there was more glove. I know we're on a podcast right now, so it's kind of a mute point for the listeners. But his hand used to sit almost on the blocking cuff of the glove, just enough that he could get his fingers to close it, to trap it, but he wanted more glove on the top side of his fingers. He's like, why would I want my hand sitting all the way in the glove? Why wouldn't I want the glove to be a further extension of my hand? And that's why a lot of people couldn't use a glove that Curtis Joseph played with, because you're like, how do you close this thing? I'm using fingertip closure because everything was so far forward. His hand actually, his knuckle area of the glove, if you could visualize this from a podcast perspective, would actually be sitting almost on the blocking cuff of the glove. It didn't even really sit inside the palm of the glove.
Was it difficult to make things that were this custom?
You know, once you get working with a player and you get to realize what they need and you've got the right people in the pro shop, you know, there's a few iterations, but repeatability is a big thing. You know, and that's one thing I always try to pride myself in, taking notes and pictures and you know, doing more listening than I do talking, and what these goalies want, and go back and work with the people in the factory who actually put the product together and sit down with them and put these products together. You know, it's repeatability is the big thing. Once you make something, okay, you made one, now I'll make 100. Or 50 or 25. That's the challenge, because it's over and over and over again. And back in the early days, it was a lot more difficult before CAD cam, right?
Right.
Everything's hand cut.
Yeah.
You know, nowadays everything's computer cut or water jet cut or laser cut. So it's a lot easier than it used to be in the old days.
Yeah. Going back to Dom real quick, just to hit on his pads. Was he one of the first guys that did angled tops on the thigh rise? Because that's another thing I adopted into my pads that I saw him do first.
Yeah.
Amongst other things, you know, I saw that his pads would sit a little higher. And I kind of took all my inspiration from goalies I'd just watch and try to figure out. I remember looking at, you know, Byron Defoe wasn't a Bauer guy, but I remember seeing that his boot strap was really loose and that his pad would shift up his legs. And so it would cover more five hole.
Right.
So that's what I thought. I got to do that. And then the angled tops that Hasek had, were his pads pretty unique too?
Yeah, they were. Him and Eddie Belfour used to do the angled tops because when they felt when they were in their butterfly, they'd seal better together without, you know, touching it. They'd create a better seal. But one thing about Dom's pads is he's pretty much the first guy that I recall having no breaks.
So stiff pads.
From the boot break right to the top, it was a solid core. There was no breaks in the core whatsoever. And he wanted them to lie flat and seal. And he was genetically built that he could play with a pad like that. I had a lot of goals.
Yeah, he was freakish.
Yeah.
There's no question. Just watch the highlights of that.
No question. So there'd be other NHL goaltenders.
Absolutely in a pretzel.
When I was dealing with Dom at the time, and he was starting to have the success that he had, saying, I want pads like Dom. And I'm like, you know, whether it's Corey Schwab or, you know, Stalenkov or different goaltenders going, you can't play in a pad like Dom. Well, no, make him like Dom, make him like Dom. Then they'd get him and they'd be like, how the heck does he play these things? These things like boards on my legs. I'm like, cause you're not built like Dom.
Right.
You know, he knows how the pad should feel on him and how he wanted it to rotate. He's one of the first guys that never used a top thigh strap.
I adopted that from him too. Yeah.
Who uses a thigh strap nowadays? Nobody. You know, at first we would put it on because he psychologically wanted it there, but he always wore it in front of his pants. You know, he would just buckle it together and eventually we took it off. But he was one of those guys like, you know, I don't need this. This does nothing. But in fact, what it does do is inhibit the rotation of the pad.
Right.
So I don't need it. Take it off. You know, right, even down to little things like a stick. You know, you look at the shoulders of a stick. There was like a, it's like a pop bottle with very rounded front and back side.
It's kind of a Coke shape, right? Like Coke bottles.
Yeah. And it was to allow for the three finger protectors of his blocker to lay flat on the ice without impeding, you know, movement of, you know, the shoulders, the feel of the stick, right? So he could get the paddle down with the three fingers down. But he even took it one step further where he said, okay, so I've got my paddle to lay flat. The shape of my shoulders allow my blocker to lay flat on the ice as well. But now I got this knob at the end of my handle that elevates the handle of my stick enough for a puck to get under. So what he started doing is cutting the back section of his knob off on the handle of his stick. So if you look on his latter days of his play, he would just have the one side of his state, his ticks, his handle of his stick taped. The backside was cut off. So it would allow a perfectly flat shaft of stick.
He was always thinking of this stuff.
Always.
Nothing was by coincidence with him.
No.
And we talked a little bit earlier about how you had Mike Richter too. And I mean, you look back as a goalie at pads and iconic sets, and he had some really cool looking stuff. He might have had the widest pads I've ever seen.
14 inches a leg.
Come on.
Yeah.
14 inches wide.
We called it.
What were they at the knee though? Because they had a cool shape to them almost, right?
He wanted an A shape to his pad. So he called it the bulbous boot. So what we used to do is we used to take ether foam. Or
are you telling me Richter actually called his pads the bulbous boot?
The bulbous boot. So the inside of the pad, we used to
take ultimate goalie trivia.
We used to take hockey pant foam, which is ether foam. We used to roll it up in balls and stuff it on the inside of his boot, just the inside, to swell it out to 14 inches. And we used to have to pre-measure it before we sent it off to him because he wanted an A-shaped frame. So wide at the bottom, gradually skinnier towards the top so he could get his knees and his thighs together because he used to, you know, hold his edges, as we call it nowadays, or stand up a little more.
Right.
Be a little more patient on his edges. And he wanted
Could skate too.
He could skate.
Unbelievable skater, yeah.
But he wanted the coverage from the lower portion of the pad as wide as possible and pushing the limits. So that's what we made the Mike Richter bulbous boot.
That's unbelievable. I think that was a Reactor 4, yes. If I remember right.
Yeah.
What? I've always wondered this though. Was it really necessary to have a Reactor 3, 4, 5, and 6 in the line?
You know, I was a product manager at that time, and Reactor 6 was...
Because the 6 was the Joseph pad, really, when he was in Toronto, right?
It was
the serial bowl blocker.
Yeah, that Reactor 6 was our series to be innovative. It was our platform to experiment, if you will. Reactor 5 was our cornerstone of the line. It was tried, tested, and true.
Yeah.
Guys like Happy Boolin, you know, would wear that product. Hashik would wear that product. And it was the line that wasn't going to let you down. And Reactor 4, we kind of we need a different feeling glove. We need a different shaped blocker.
Nabokov was all Reactor 4.
Yes. Nabby.
Yanni Herme was Reactor 4.
Yeah. And we had the Tower graphic, which those guys were more stand-up goalies, if you will.
It's a cool graphic, though, too.
Yeah, we called it the tower graphic. It tried to make the pad stretch it out, seem taller than it actually was, right? And then Reactor 3, we thought, okay, this is really our mid-price point line.
We'll give it to Guy Bear.
We'll give it to a guy that wears something very traditional. And when we picked up Guy, it was perfect because it fit along the lines of his heating pads, his Pro 90s, right? It was knee rolls. Because if you remember Reactor 5, they're diagonal shitty.
They were, Which Reactor 3 was straight. We look back now, though, the Reactor 5 was such a traditional pad by today's standards.
Oh, yeah.
Which is hilarious to think, you know, like it was still kind of groundbreaking when it came out back then.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And, you know, Guy Bear was one of my favorite goalies to work with. He was just so easy. That guy was so good. He could play in anything. You know, he was a quick convert into Bauer. And you know, he really, that was our volume line, Reactor 3 at the time. And he was a good ambassador to have representing it, the whole graphic presentation. I think Stevie Dillon did a Reactor 3 graphic on one of his Ice Dog pads this year, you know, like the half moon shape. It was, it's cool. I'm sure there's a few other goalies that have paid tribute to it. And everybody used to say, why no Reactor 2? Well, I don't know, because we kind of ran out of 6, 5, 4, 3, and 1 was our opening price point.
Yeah.
And I don't know. There was just no space for a 2, I guess.
I've got to ask this, and I'm not going to ask you anything specific with it in terms of numbers, but was there a lot of cash flying around to goalies back in the day then?
Not as much as there.
Because I think there's this perception that goalies are just making millions off endorsements. And there is money out there, but was there a certain time frame, though, where there was kind of an arms race?
Yes.
Because there used to be a lot of companies involved in the game, more so than there is now.
You know, I'd say back to 2000 and sort of 2010, 2008, that was kind of where things really started to escalate out of control.
Was it tough to deal with that from the rep side?
For me, if the first thing out of a player's mouth was the endorsement side of it, I knew that the next brand that came along that offered something better, I was out. So it always came down to product.
Right.
We never got caught up into paying big dollars. Yeah, you know, back in the day when we wanted to get Curtis Joseph out of Louisville and, you know, Hasek into being a brand ambassador and different guys like that, the dollars weren't what they were back in, you know, 2000s when I said that time frame. But, you know, we paid it because, you know, it was a brand driver, you know.
Would you say the majority of guys, though, really would go with a brand that they liked the product first and foremost, and then whatever came after that was just gravy?
Yeah, a lot of it. You know,
there had to be a couple guys out there, though, that were just chasing the buck, I'm sure.
Oh, there was a lot of guys that were chasing the buck, and a lot of it was their agents chasing the buck. So they played, you know, back then there was more goalie companies, right?
I mean, now we're streamlined now. There's like 4 of us.
Yeah, right. So back then there was, you know, a lot more than that.
Yeah.
The agents would play brand against brand against brand. And at some point you had to realize what's right for the brand. And, you know, like if I'll take this for example, if Patrick Bois ever switched in the Bauer, they know it would be a cash grab.
Right.
There's certain guys who would not resonate because they've been one brand for so long. They'd know it was a cash grab, and it almost looked like, you know, we thought it was not a good marketing strategy to be throwing around money, getting guys to switch. It had to be predicated on the likes of our product and what they could do for our brand. And did their persona resonate outside of the playing area? For example, a Henrik Lundqvist. New York might not be a great hockey market per se from an amateur hockey standpoint, registration standpoint, or retail environment. But Hanke sells a lot of product in Sweden.
Right.
So, you know, it's the same thing with, you know.
He's a big-time driver on NBC when he's on the national television, everything else like that.
Yeah, right? The television market. It's the same thing with Kippersoff, right?
Right.
Kipper was a wallflower. He never did media interviews. he He's a fly under the radar type of guy. But for us, it opened the eyes to a lot of good young goalies in Finland when we picked him up and help open the door to get those guys. And Kipper, same thing. It was just, he just liked the product. We liked the service and what we did, what we were able to do for him.
Let's talk about him for a bit, because he was a guy who'd use gear right into the ground, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, how long would he use a set of gear for?
Until the equipment manager had to take it out of his stall.
Like physically take it out of there.
Take it out, and he would actually hide it, put it in a pro shop to be sold, throw it in the garbage, whatever he had to do. I was dealing with that time with Mark DiPasquale, and Mark would be like, you know, yeah, Kip won't switch. I have to literally pull the stuff out of his stall, and he'd come in going, where's my pads? Right there. Well, no, those are the new ones. Where are my old, where are my pads? They're gone, Kip. You got to get into these. Like, it's, they're done.
So the equipment guys are probably sick of repairing them, I would imagine, at that point.
You know, yeah, there is little things that would go wrong with them. But for the most part, you know, they were just, they knew it was a safety issue. They were breaking down, or he'd be complaining about bad goals because the rebounds weren't coming off the product like he normally would anticipate, right? Well, yeah, it's, everything's been broken down. So you're not going to get the same type of rebound trajectory off the product. So you let out errant rebounds that normally you wouldn't let out because the product failed you. So they're doing what was in the best interest of the goalie, but the goalie was so used to the product that they didn't want to give it up.
How many sets of gear were guys using? I mean, was it kind of the typical two pads, four gloves and blockers for a long time? Because now we're starting to see a lot more gear used, it seems like.
Right.
What's been the projection of that over time?
It's been huge. It's threefold, fourfold. You know, I had, remember the 1 year when we were talking about this earlier at dinner tonight, Chris Mason in St. Louis, when he was a starter there, he went through the same set of pads, Vapor X60s, okay, all one season into the playoffs, and then took him over to the world championships with him. And I was so impressed by that. I actually had him send him back to Bauer. And I'm sure if you talk to some of the people that you deal with at Bauer, because I'm not there anymore, they probably still have those pads around in the office in the museum.
Bronzed them.
Because, you know,
we got to reverse engineer this set and see what we did right.
Yeah. You know, it's like part performance, part mostly psychological, that I can't give these things up. You know, I'm having such a great year in them. They just feel like a natural extension of my body. And I remember talking to Mace about things like that. But now, you know, I'm with Vaughn now, and you talk to guys like, you know, I deal with Peter Mrazek. He's gone through five sets of pads and 10 sets of gloves. And he's played what? 30 some odd games at this point, 35, 36 games at this point, you know, a set of pads every seven games, eight games.
So obviously it's a guy who likes a new feeling of his pads, I imagine.
New feeling of his pads and gloves. And, you know, he just likes them to feel a certain way. And once they start to feel a little sloppy or a little loose or not quite the same as new, it's time for a new set. And that's not to say that the product's broken down or failing. It's just a priority of his. And I think then a lot of the younger goalies coming up feel the same way. I'm not saying all of them do, because there are certain goalies who still like to, no, I've got this exactly where I like it. I really hate breaking in new gear. Yeah. But I think the majority of goalies nowadays like new gear.
Who else do you have in your stable right now?
Yeah, I've got 10 NCAA Division I men's and women's teams. I've got five NHL teams and three CHL teams. So it's a good cross-section of goalies that I deal with. We at Vaughn, we do very well with our pants and chest and arms. Our product, you know, pads and gloves speak for themselves. We got two very good lines in our SLR2 and our V8, and the new V9 stuff looks fantastic. So, yeah, you know, we're a pretty established brand, and it's been going well.
So you guys are using a lot of carbon fiber now, right?
Yeah, you know,
it's kind of finally worked its way into goalie gear.
It's a little more expensive.
It's lighter.
It's lighter. It doesn't break down as quick. It retains its shape. strategically used, it gives you more pop, which means it gives you more propulsion on impact. So, you know, you get bigger rebounds to kick it away from your blue paint area.
Which for anybody that's listening that thinks bigger rebounds are a problem,
right?
I have never subscribed to that. I always want the puck as far away from me as I can get it as quickly as possible. And, so, and that's kind of something that has only become in vogue in the last several years. People caught on to that.
Right.
You know,
and everybody's using different materials to accomplish that. And carbon fiber is one of the ways that, that we use it strategically layered with the different foams, the HD foams or the Evazote foams that we use to accomplish that.
Over all the years you've done this, have there been any goalies that you think, I bet this guy could just take this right off the shelf and use it? I mean, like a strictly stock pad from the shelf.
You know, I think Dom was that good.
Really?
Yeah, I think that he just, he could have, look at his career trajectory in terms of product. Cooper, Bryant's, CSS, you know, Bauer.
Great saves? Do you ever have those? Great or is that saves.
No, he TPS, you know. Yeah. He just dialed it in to make him that much better. But I think if you just issued him equipment, he could have played in it. You know, there's other guys that I dealt with who were took it to the extreme, like Ed Belfour. I dealt with him when he was one of the first guys when he was wearing Miller stuff and he converted over to Cooper.
Yeah.
And then, you know, we tried to keep him happy when Glenn Miller wasn't making his product anymore. And, you know, he's one of the first guys who, to the best of my knowledge, the innovator of the floating T-trap.
Yeah, that's right. I remember seeing that for the first time and thinking, what's going on here?
Right.
It's not connected to the, it's only skate lace behind it.
Right.
Yeah.
The angled tops, the pads, to your reference earlier. He's one of the first guys, I remember that, the higher hand position on the blocker, like Hasek.
I'd love to talk gear with him. That's one guy that I looked at a lot because he was playing for the Blackhawks. I grew up in St. Louis.
Mm-hmm.
So he'd come to town and it was the same thing, whether it was the sticks, pads, you name it. And even as his career went on, I wrote a piece for this for InGoal magazine about how he changed his career, went from being a really wide butterfly really early in his career to a little bit more upright as he got older. And part of that was based on his body, his back was having problems, but he was constantly evolving and innovating. And I mean, did some of the things that he or other goaltenders bring to you as a rep make their way into the product lines?
Always. There was always some element of what they brought that would make its way into the line. You know, one interesting story I had with Ed, and we brought him into our old Bauer factory on Eastgate Parkway. We were there till like, I think, the wee hours of the morning, and we had pucks, and he was throwing it at different densities of foam, whether it's HD 80, HD 115, LD foams, and throwing pucks. We put a board of foam against the wall and he'd see how far it would bounce. I'm going, what are you trying to achieve by this? Because this is not really replicating what this would do when it's layered and when it's on your leg and it's in a game situation. And I would be like, well, you know, this one seems to die when I throw it. I'm going, okay. And he goes, this one bounces further. So which one do you think we should use? And we just like, here we go round and round. And it's like 12:30 at night. And I'm like, Ed, you have to fly out tomorrow morning early. And really, I don't know where we're going with this, but, you know, he was one of those guys who just wanted to get it right.
It's still
and
pretty
give him every advantage.
It's still, you know, pretty cool though that he was that into his gear.
But I was so tired.
Yeah.
I just wanted to go.
Just gassed you.
Yeah.
Right?
At this point, I'm like going, it's okay. We'll figure some combination out that makes sense for you, but throwing pucks at a foam board placed flat against a wall that has no give is not going to give you any indication of how the puck's going to react.
Where was this, like in his basement? Where
no,
were
this
you?
Was at the factory.
At the factory itself. Okay.
So we would fly him.
It would have been better if
gear.
It, like, it was in his basement.
Oh, no, just throwing pucks. Yeah, no. yeah, no. This was at the factory, but it was like at night, at midnight, and we're going through this, and
the janitors are cleaning up the place.
Oh,
and
they're
he's still
long
throwing pucks.
They're long. I mean, it's crickets outside. It's everybody who should be sleeping is sleeping, except for us. We're throwing pucks at the wall.
So you've done this for a long time, and I'm wondering if you can dig in your bank here and think of one thing that was an absolute home run that you may not have expected to be, and then one thing that you thought was going to be game-changing and just was a dud and did not work.
Yep.
You got one for both.
Yeah, game-changing, which is a dud and did not work, Vapor 30 gold pads.
I tried them. I tried my best with those, man.
I think a lot of goalies did.
Peter Budaj, I was the only guy who made him work.
And to this day, if you ask Boots, he'll tell you that was his favorite pad.
That's unbelievable. I could not get those. I like the glove and the blocker a lot.
Right.
But I couldn't get the pads to go.
You know, and you look at the way blockers are being designed, you know, in something close to your heart, the Bauer line.
Right.
I think it's the new, is it 2X blocker?
I think so.
It's a thin profile, and it's...
I got a couple demos apparently coming at some point.
Yeah.
It's basically the vapor.
It's a vapor blocker. Right. Yeah. And I reached out to somebody who I'm still friends with at Bauer, and I said, oh, you brought the old Vapor 30 profile back. He goes, it took a lot of convincing. He goes, but it made sense. And I said, you're right, it does.
Yeah, that blocker made sense.
Yeah.
Yep.
So, you know, the whole Vapor 30 goal pad premise... And I remember going around showing retailers, not so much pros this, but retailers this. And they were like, wow, this thing, dude, is so cool the way it looks. But you got to flatten it out. You know, you can't have these elevations. And I'm like, well, the elevations are because the designer thinks they're really cool looking and will help differentiate our product from everything that's out there. And they're like, well, you know, goalies don't like to be shocked into new products. They like to be progressed or graduate into it. And I'm like, I know, but we're trying to make a statement product here. And they're like, I'm telling you, dude, if you just flatten this out, you've got a home run.
It's kind of like how the Blockade didn't take off because it was ahead of its time. It's the same way.
If we would have made the Vapor like the feedback that we were receiving, it probably would have had the same success as the initial launch year Reebok. Wow. Yeah. And... you know, being a manager of a design team.
To go to a truly flat face.
Yes.
Pad,
right? Being a manager of a design team at that time, I gave my designers the latitude and I respected where the direction they were going, but it just didn't work.
Right.
And the whole chamber, the air chamber on impact, that the air would disperse. We had the vent ports that would blow the air out. And we, in the marketing videos, we put the blue powder in the chamber and impacted it, and the blue powder would puff out the side of the vent ports. Great visuals, great story, great concept. Disney, it was story. It didn't resonate. But I'm telling you, the sell-in at retail was great for that product. The sell-through, not so much. A lot of our retail partners were stuck with trying to move that product. So that had a lot of hype behind it.
Yeah.
And that was something that disappointed us. But in hindsight, and you know, going into it, I had a feeling, a nervous feeling, that it wasn't going to succeed because too many people told us that it was just too far ahead of its time. And it was shocking. A product that was a home run. You know, Reactor 6 was a home run.
You didn't really expect it to be? Or was it just kind of an innovative slash?
It was our platform to do creative stuff that wasn't the peanut-shaped blocker.
Right.
You know?
The cereal bowl. Yeah.
Right. The knee fanned-out knee rolls.
I love that glove, too. The Reactor 6 glove I used for years.
A concaved, the first concave cuff.
Right.
Right? A little more recent. You know, I'd have to say the Bauer 1S goal skate, you know, as part of that. And I looked at that and go, I'm not sure how accounting list. Well, you remember I brought prototypes out to you.
Right.
How is this going to work out? You know, it's even when I showed Lundquist it, he was like, it's a nice looking skate. It looks way better than having a cowling on. But he was even skeptical, but everybody throws the word game changer around very loosely, but there's very few products that are game changers. And that was a game changer.
Isn't it crazy now that when you go to watch youth kids, you hardly see a cowling out there?
Right.
And this has only been in the last 3 years.
Yeah.
4 years. It's unbelievable to think that goalie skates that didn't have a cowling look so odd to us and out of place before, that's now the normal occurrence. Well, that's what it is.
You know, thank you for reminding me of that. Composite goal sticks.
Yeah.
Louisville was one of the first to have one. And then they had, they went from full composite, which was red one. And for the name, you know.
I remember it had a little grip paddle on it.
Yeah. And that was awesome. And yeah. I wish I had one. And yeah. I wish I would have kept it. I was working at Bauer at the time and I had one. And I thought, this stick is really, really cool. It's going to kill me not to remember the name of that. But then they came out the following year with one that had wood inserts to replicate a wood feel. And that was really cool too.
Yeah.
And then we came out with Vapor 30. So we weren't Bauer wasn't the first, but we were the first to do it right.
Yeah.
Crushed it.
I was in composite sticks, I think 7 years ago.
Yeah.
Maybe the second year they came out, I had them.
And the only reason we didn't do it for you sooner is because the molds were cost prohibitive.
Yeah.
But it took that long to make it that we could make the molds a little more palatable from a manufacturing standpoint, that we could start offering it up to everybody that wanted one.
Yeah. Well, and the insanity of the whole thing, though, is that I was playing pro hockey on an NHL contract. And back at the time, team I was playing with didn't want to buy them for me.
Right.
So I'm trying to play hockey to the best of my ability. And they won't buy me composite sticks that are better than the things on the market because they're too expensive.
A lot of teams didn't. Pushback.
The ironic part, though, is that I didn't end up using as many as wood. I wasn't breaking them.
But like any in a traditional market like hockey with a traditional mentality, the mindset is always one of skepticism. And, you know, when we came out with that composite goalie stick, there was a lot of pushback to it. Oh, the handles break too easy. And a lot of those things were reality because we were still fine tuning it, but it was a performance product and it wasn't going to be as durable as a plywood or aspen handle that you would have on a wood stick or a foam core goal stick, but the balance was going to be better. The kick points were going to be much better
They're thinner. You can put pucks out of the ballpark much easier. Every reason why the players were switching to composite sticks are the exact same reason why all the goalies are switching to them.
Right.
It just was a delayed process.
Right. And you go into any rink nowadays, and I'm in a rink not only for business, but, you know, because my daughter plays and I attend a lot of goal schools, and as she was growing up playing, I don't see any kids carrying foam core goal sticks. Mm-hmm. Wood? No. I don't even know if they exist, to be honest with you. I'm sure there may be one or two brands that still make, you know, at the lower price points, a plywood goal stick. But even foam core, it's dying a slow, painful death. And that's because every composite only makes sense, especially when you could bring it down to the price points they're bringing it down at now. Maybe not as much carbon fiber content, but fiberglass content, they're durable, they're lighter. You can play the puck better with them. It's just, why wouldn't you use them?
And they're so consistent.
And consistent.
You know, I used to get a batch of a dozen. The best sticks I honestly ever owned were probably Sherwood PMP or whatever, 9950s or whatever they were way back in the late 90s. Were probably the best ones I ever owned. But I'd get a dozen of them and probably 3 to 4 of them were good.
Right.
Now, the rest of them would all be off in some way.
Because they're hand-shaped.
Yeah. And the composites are bang on every single one.
Yeah. Because they're out of a mold.
They're not quite as good as those old school wood ones, but man, they're so consistent. I know exactly what I'm getting out of them.
Right.
Every time.
Yeah. You just tape them up.
Yeah.
You know, and one thing in the early days, a funny story, is that I used to have, when I would go in to see goalies, whether it's a Cam Ward back in his Carolina days, because he was one of the first guys using our composite goal stick, or Thomas Vilcoon in Nashville. Mm-hmm. You'd go in and they would bitch about the sticks breaking. And I'm like, okay, we'll look after it. And, you know, where's it breaking? And you go through it with them and they're like, I'm not mad the stick's breaking. I'm mad that I spent 20 minutes taping this thing and it broke on the first shot in practice. Okay. All right. That's interesting. He's not mad that it broke. He's interested that he wasted time taping it. Then you go to talk to the equipment manager and he's like, these things cost 3 times the price of a foam stick. And I'm like, well, your goalie's not mad that it broke. Yes, he is. I'm like, he's mad because he spent 20 minutes of his time taping it and it broke. He's not mad that the stick broke. He's mad that he wasted time taping the stick that broke in first shot. So it was like, oh my goodness, like the growing pains that we had to cut our teeth with that have now become the norm in the industry. Right. You know, it's funny to recollect and go back and think about those days.
You mentioned it here that you've got a daughter playing hockey that's a goaltender. Mm-hmm. And I've got a daughter who's going to be 6. She's learning how to skate. She really wants to play goalie. My wife hates that idea. Ultimate betrayal, she considers it to be.
Right.
In my heart of hearts, though, it'd be pretty awesome to share that with her. Something that I've made a living out of. It's been my life's passion. How's it been for you and your daughter to have that relationship?
You know, and, you know, your wife experienced it on a different level. You being a professional, playing the position and earning a livelihood. You know, I earned a livelihood being in the hockey business. And yeah, we didn't move around town to town like you and your wife have and the stress that puts on a family. But my wife had to deal with me being in hockey and bringing home whatever pressures or frustrations I had. And then to see me want to have one of our kids in hockey and not only work in it, but then have to go play in it or support our kids. She was frustrated too.
Same deal.
So she never wanted my daughter to play hockey, let alone be a goaltender. And I didn't either. This is a buddy of mine who pushed my daughter into it because they were on a travel team and they didn't have a goalie. And he was like, you got to have your daughter come out. And I'm like, no, 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 no. And then he eventually had a goalie who wasn't up to their expectations. And they're like, you got to have your daughter come on. I'm like going, what makes you think that my daughter is going to be better than a goalie you already have?
Well, she's going to have sweet gear.
And that's what he said. She's going to have sweet gear and she's going to have a dad who's hooked in with people who could train her. And how many people could say that their first personal goalie coach was Ben Vanderklok?
Yeah.
Which was Torrey's goalie coach. And then Mitch Korn. And so she, you know, and to her credit, she had to put the effort behind it and the attention to detail and the passion, and she did it. And, you know, it's embrace it. And I always told Tori, when I don't see you skating around with a smile on your face in that cage, it's over. You know, I don't care how far she goes. And it's such an experience. We talked about this tonight. You'll have a great time with your daughter, but once that smile has gone off the face, then it's time to look for another avenue of sport or entertainment and, you know, just enjoy it while you can. And it will be fun. You'll have a blast, but you can't get too involved. Like everybody looks at, I've had a lot of coaches come up to me and say, you're not a psycho goalie parent, but you work in the hockey business. Not only do you work in the hockey business, you're in the goalie sector. You should be over the top. I've had goalie parents that like, are nuts and you're not anything. I'm like, honestly, because I understand it. I've seen it from different levels, NHL right down. It's about the kids. Parents love to compare. Kids love to compete. And I just want my kids to have fun. And we should go somewhere. Great. If not, you know what? Let's not get crazy about things. It's the 1%. And the chances you're going to be in the 1% are slim to none.
That's all I'm hoping for.
Yeah.
I just want her to have fun. Exactly. That's all my dad ever did for me. Just let me play.
Enjoy it. And you'll enjoy it. I see you're going to have fun with it. You're encourage it. Your wife will go along with it. And she might even become the crazy goalie parent. You never know. She might become the crazy goalie parent. You'll be like, hey, you got to settle down here. You're starting to embarrass us.
I'll be hanging out in the corner of the rink.
Yeah.
Eating a pack of M&Ms like my dad.
That's what I do.
Yeah.
Stay away from everybody else. Do your own thing and just observe, play. Yeah.
So what's coming down the pipeline? If you had to look into the future, I mean, you've seen 30 years of goaltending and innovation and equipment and a huge amount of change in this time. Do you really see a new frontier that can be conquered here?
You know, it's become increasingly more difficult with the parameters that the NHL have put on because they've really outlaid the design and the parameters of what the equipment could look like. But No, you know, I see there's a lot of companies out there that are working with technology that could replace foam. And anywhere there's foam, I think there could be an engineered structure that takes the place of foam.
Hmm.
Just like deer hair was replaced by foam, I think foam can be replaced by something else. Something a little more streamlined, something lighter, something that absorbs and dissipates impact, something that may be fine-tuned. I just...
Active suspension for goaltenders?
Could be. Or, yeah. You know what? I think it... You know, it's all going to come down to return on investment.
Yeah.
And that's the thing that I think would hold back the advancement is going to be, because hockey's a small sport. Goaltending's 1/10 the overall size of the hockey market, the goal equipment sector. It's going to be the return on investment that's going to hold back the advancements. But there's a lot of possibilities out there.
Cool.
Yeah.
I won't be around to see it other than being a hockey dad.
I hope I'm retired and I could view it from afar.
Yeah. Well, it'll be fun. Man, I'm sure we could do 5 more of these. And we're definitely going to have to come back and do just a strictly Tim Thomas equipment podcast special.
Yeah, we could fill up an hour on that.
That's awesome. Well, thanks so much for sitting down for a little over an hour now.
Thanks for having me.
I can't wait to go back for round 2.
Yeah, it's going to be fun. I look forward to it.
Thanks, bro.
All the best to you.
Thanks for listening to 6 Degrees with Mike McKenna. Please make sure that you like, comment, leave a rating, subscribe, whether it's iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, anywhere that you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.